Hello students, hello everybody. Hearty congratulations to all the toppers and all the happy students who have cleared gate in success, coloring in colorful means. I wish you all success. Let us see what is the next step and how can we proceed with the gate score and what is the, where all we can use this gate score and how to take it to the next level. Okay. So let us understand the importance of the gate score. As we know already, using gate, its gate is the passport for you to get into your M.Tech or MS from the most prestigious institutes in India, like Indian Institute of Science or IITs and other prestigious institutions in India and R&D sector in India. Of course, this is another budding craze for gate is PSUs and JRF in DRDO or in JRF. This is not only in DRDO, it's inclusive of BRC and Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research, Baba Atomic Research Center, all these places. So it's a very, very promising career. And then gate score is also useful for applying in foreign, especially in Singapore, where we have Nanyang Technical University and National University of Singapore. And then there are also very good management and industrial engineering program in IIT Kanpur and NIT. Let us see the order of preference. So this is vague, I mean this is what is the general trend, okay. So this may vary from year to year, like it may vary a bit, but this is what has been the gross trend across last 15 to 20 years. So always students prefer microelectronics, VLSI and microelectronics as the first choice. The toppers are always preferring VLSI and microelectronics as the best choice because it's a very, very promising field and has an excellent career opportunity. And then it's related to electronic systems engineering. We have very beautiful courses in electronic systems engineering in called as Department of Systems Engineering in Indian Institute of Science, and also there is electronic systems engineering, systems and control engineering offered in IIT Bombay. All these things are very, very sort of hot cakes, and it sells like hot cakes. So students are really hunting for the streets to get into these places there. Especially the IISc and IIT's electronic systems engineering is going to give you the best, the most promising career you would have imagined if you are interested in career in electronics, especially. And then robotics and control and mechatronics are almost the third and the fourth field, that is robotics and control and mechatronics. They are almost aligned with each other. So that's the next very, very famous sought field. We have very beautiful courses in robotics and control mechatronics in IIT Delhi, in IIT Bombay, as well as in IIT Madras. And control and automation, we have it in Indian Institute of Science. And we have other instrumentation related courses that are available in IIT Kharagpur, has IIT M.Tech in instrumentation. We have courses related to electronics and instrumentation in other top premium institutes as well. So this is the order of preference which has been the trend in the last, at least for the last decade or a couple of decades. And then off late, people have shown interest because the electronics merging into our day-to-day life very much, power electronics has become an invariable part of our life. So, though earlier, a decade before, power electronics was looked at a pure electrical only paper, now it's crossing its lines and merging with other disciplines. So, even any people who is having an electronics and instrumentation background are also allowed to take power electronics. So, this is also a very, very promising career if you are interested. But being an instrumentation guys, the instrumentation students tend to prefer it less. But from career point of view, it is as promising as any other field listed here. So, coming to the very, very famous question, the most sorted out question is, what is M.Tech and what is MS? What is the difference? So, just to have a quick idea of this, M.Tech is going to be course intensive. This is going to be more course intensive. In the sense, you will be taking more theory subjects, you will be doing more labs, just like the way you did your college. Like, for example, you had 7 semesters of theory when you did theory and lab when you did your B.Tech, and the last 8 semester was full of project, or you had 1 or 2 papers along with project. So M.Tech is going to be almost like that. It's almost going to be, the pattern is going to be like B.E. Three semesters of courses plus lab and 1 semester of project. This is what M.Tech is. And in case of MS, it's going to be more lab oriented, lab slash research oriented. So here you will do 1 to 1.5 semesters of coursework. No, don't think that what I mean by half semester, there's nothing called as half semester. What I mean is, you will be, let us say for example, in M.Tech, you will be doing, let us say 12 courses. So it will be like 4 courses in Sem 1, 4 courses in Sem 2, and 4 courses in Sem 3, and Sem 4 will be project. Here, what I mean by half a semester is, you will be, this varies from institute to institute, you will be doing 5 to 6 courses. So many people whom I have seen, they do like this. They take 4 courses in Sem 1 and 2 courses in Sem 2. Something like this. That's what I mean by 1 to 1.5 semesters of coursework. Remaining all is going to be project work, or you'll be doing your thesis. From employability perspective, many people, they think that if you do MS, you are less chances of employment. M.Tech gets more chances of employment. There's nothing like that. M.Tech and MS have equally promising career options and job opportunities. Especially if you're interested in PhD, go for MS. MS will take you to PhD much more easily, because whatever you want to do as a research in PhD, you would have laid the foundation stone of that in your MS research itself here. You can extend this research thesis, what you have done in your MS, to take it to a PhD. That's the advantage of MS program. So many people may think that MS will take close to 3 years. It will take anywhere around 2.5 to 3 years. It will take always 2 years. So the reason students prefer M.Tech most is, in 2 years, you finish the course and come out of the institute. There's nothing like, you need not prolong it. But in case of MS, it may take as long as 3 years, or it may go to 3.5 years also. It all depends upon how well your project work and your research paper comes out. So because of this extra 1 year or 1.5 year effort, students are preferring it less. But it's not that MS is some bad course or something. MS, in India, you get MS opportunities from Indian Institute of Science. They call it MSc Engineering. You get MS opportunities from IIT Madras and IIT Delhi. These are the most promising courses available in India, and the best research facilities available in India. You can take this forward to a new level, and you can take it very closer to a PhD. From here to PhD, it's going to be very easy for you if you're really interested in PhD. If you're not interested in PhD, even then, if you're interested in job, MS is equally marketable as much as M.Tech. Rather, MS, you will learn things more practically. That's very good in that point of view. Then, this is another famous question that's being sought out. Like, what is the... Okay, I have cleared gate. Okay, sir, I got, a rank of 50 or rank of 100 or something like that. So, what is the next procedure? How do I go for M.Tech admissions? That's the next famous sort of questions. So, the procedure of admission, if I say, it varies from IIT to IIT. It all depends, but broad trend is like this. In case of M.Tech, you get direct admissions. In case of MS, you don't get direct admissions. You will have interview. And then, you have, in case of few IITs, for few courses, they take interview also on top of GATE. And for few courses, they take GATE plus they conduct another round of written exam and another round of interview. I'll just give you a few examples here. It will be making it more clear. See, for example, there is nothing in same IITs also for different branches the rules differ. So the best point, reference point for this is to refer to the IITs and IISc's admission brochure. So I'll just give you a quick idea. Let us take IISc, the best institute in India. They have something called as ME programs and they have something called as M.Tech in Instrumentation Engineering. For these programs, they take direct admission. Based on gate score. Okay. In same IISc, there is a department called as Department of Electronic Systems Engineering. This is where I graduated from. This is the best place in India to study the Electronic Systems Engineering course. Here, they take gate plus written test. Plus interview. Now, if I come to the next famous institute in India, IIT Bombay and IIT Madras. Here, M.Tech only gate score, direct admission. Here, you have M.Tech, except for one branch called as System Science, if I recollect correctly, it's Systems and Control Engineering. Here they take gate plus interview. All other branches, direct gate score. In IIT Roorkee, they take, for M.Tech, they take gate plus interview. So the reason I wrote all these things here is, it varies from IIT to IIT. And here, even within the IIT, if you see, for few courses you have gate plus interview, for few courses you have direct admission. You have few courses direct admission, you have few courses gate plus written test plus admission. Okay, and here you have direct admission. And for MS, this is for M.Tech. Okay, this varies from IIT to IIT or the institute to institute. If I go to MS, always you will have interview is 100%, interview is compulsory. Gate plus interview is the trend always. And optionally, there may be a written test. What do I mean by optional is not, it's not optional to the students. The IIT or IISc decides that. If the number of applications they are getting is more, they may decide to have a written test or they want to have one more round of filtering or something like that. They can have a written test. That's what I'm saying. That varies from IIT to IIT and the amount of craze or the amount of applications they are getting for that subject. They decide it from year to year basis. Okay. And in subsequent slides, I'm going to present the trends and the ranks and what you can expect out of your gate score. These are based on the general trends. The trend, we have not seen trend varying that greatly in the last decade or a decade and a half. So based on that, the next slides are being proposed. So, of course, anybody who is writing, anybody who wants to do M.Tech or M.S. in India, the dream institute for anybody in India is always IISc. It's the best institute you have for the best rated institute or in India. And recently many people may also have heard about this. Recently IISc was rated one among the top 10 institutions in the world. So, and it has the best research opportunity in the science and technology field in India. So if you want to really get into IISc, IISc M.Tech is going to be less than 30 ranks, or to be very honest, not even 30, it should be less than 15 ranks, I will say. For IIT Bombay, because I have written IISc and IIT Bombay together, this IIT Bombay is the next most sorted institute. For here, the rank will be around 15 to 30, something like this. So your rank has to be literally within less than 30 combinedly. Okay, that's for IIT and IIT Bombay and IISc Bangalore. The next famous chartered institutes are the other IITs, which is listed, IIT Delhi, Kanpur and Madras. These are the older IITs, which are the premium ones and very, very sought out. So for getting ranks into these IITs, your rank has to be less than 100. Okay, these are the broad trends. Okay, it may differ. Let us say when I say 100, it may be the last rank that may get, that's getting admission may be 80 or 120. There will be plus or minus 10-20 ranks variation this side and that side. And then, if your gate rank is in the order of, all these ranks I am talking are, by the way, from instrumentation rank point of view, the IN paper point of view, not the EC or EEE rank point of view. Because the amount of seats available for instrumentations are a bit lesser compared to the amount of seats, because the amount of candidates applying in instrumentation are also less. So what happens is, your rank has to be literally little bit above the, or let us say a gate rank of 200, when I say gate rank of 80 in EC or EEE and gate rank of 40 in instrumentation will become comparable with each other, because the students' density is much less in instrumentation paper because of that I'm saying. So all the ranks given here are indicative of instrumentation based ranks, not the general ranks in, as in EC or EEE. Okay. So the next famous sorted institutes are the IIT Kharagpur. Okay, and IISc has MSc engineering program. So this is a very beautiful point I want you to note here. So if you are very, very interested in getting into IISc, and let us say your rank is around 120 or 150, something like this, you need not lose your heart. Instead of M.Tech program, you can enroll for MS by research program, MSc engineering. That MS by research, this program in IISc, it's called as MSc engineering. So, this program, you can get admission if your rank is in the order of 120 to 150, or it may be even up to 200. Up to 200 also. But the only thing is, here you will have a written test plus interview or only interview depending upon department. Depending on the department you are applying, it may vary. So if you are really very much, sorting to do a research in IISc, this is a very good program. Though your rank is bit on the lower side, you still stand a chance to get into IISc because of this. And also one interesting part here is, even if you want to do M.Tech in IISc, one department is there called Department of Electronic Systems Engineering. If your rank falls in this category, also you can apply for this program, because they don't look at your gate score only. It is gate plus written test plus interview. This is how they categorize it. So if your gate rank is coming little bit down and still you are good in your basic concepts, you can still crack this written test and interview and get into IISc, or you can crack the MS engineering interview and get into IISc. It's a very, very promising opportunity. And other famous institute in this rank range you will get will be IIT Roorkee, IIT BHU. Now IIT BHU has also become IIT of late, and you have IIT Guwahati. These are the seven old IITs which existed long back. And after this, we have all the new IITs coming. So if your rank is above 300, you can try for all these new IITs. Okay, so many people, they think that these new IITs are bad or something like that. For just to give you an idea, I'll tell you. Though these IITs are new, the faculties there, the minimum criteria to join as a faculty in IIT is, you should be a postdoc from foreign or a PhD with some 3 to 4 years of research experience from a foreign university. Or if you have done your PhD in India, you should have at least a minimum of postdoc from foreign university. Or if you have done your PhD in India, you should have at least some 5 to 6 years of very good research record. This is the criteria for getting into IIT as a faculty. So, and these IITs, though they are new, in spite of that, their faculties are highly qualified and talented. So you need not think that this is a new IIT, so it's not that great or that good or something. These IITs are very good and they offer you a promising career. The only thing what I mean, the only sort of the point which keeps this IIT less sorted out is these IITs are coming up in their facilities. So the amount of lab facilities or the research facilities which will be available in IISc, IIT Bombay, IIT Delhi, that may not be available in all these IITs. But still, the from the standard of the course or the marketability of your course point of view, like regarding your job opportunities after you did your M.Tech, it's these IITs are as promising as the other IITs. We have done with all the IITs. The next sorted institutes will be all the premium NITs. So the premium NIT, the best NIT in India is NIT Trichy, Warangal and Suratkal. These are the top three NITs in India. So these are the next sorted out branches. Especially if you are interested in process control instrumentation, because you guys are instrumentation guys, there is a branch of engineering called process control instrumentation. NIT Trichy offers a M.Tech in process control instrumentation, or rather it's one of the very few institutes in India which is offering you M.Tech in process control instrumentation. This course is very, very good if you are interested in a career in say in a refinery or a power plant, in the because every power plant and refineries, they need process control instrumentation, and the design of that and all are being taught in this course. It's a very good course. Going further, other NITs are the famous colleges, and then once these NITs are done, people also on parallel with NIT Trichy and all, BITS Pilani, they are not accepting the GATE score, but BITS conduct their own entrance exam. But in case you have done your preparation for GATE, so the BITS Pilani entrance exam will be on par with, means if you are prepared for GATE, that exam should be straightforward for you to crack it up. So that should be a good opportunity for you. It's not listed in this because I have listed the institutes only which accept GATE score. And then we have Jadavpur University in Kolkata, and we have Anna University in Chennai, we have Vishveshwara Technical University in Karnataka, we have Delhi College of Engineering in Delhi. All these they accept. Okay. I think I take my statement back. I think from last couple of years, BITS Pilani is accepting GATE score as well. I'll update that. Okay, then we have, if your rank is more than 700, then you can go and look into the government universities, like we have the respective universities like Madras University or Bangalore University or whatever, the respective universities of the government engineering colleges, and we have the private engineering colleges. But my suggestion, if I'm not with due respect to all these institutes, not to say that these institutes are bad or anything. What I will prefer is, if your rank is falling in this category and if you have a chance to give a GATE next year, try for that. That, because the fact that you got a GATE rank of in this range, some, let us say around 800, 850 in your first attempt, definitely you stand a very good chance if it is permitting, if your situation is permitting you to take up GATE next year. I'll prefer you to give a GATE, an honest attempt for GATE one, and give yourself one another chance. Because these colleges I'm not sure, many of these colleges, I'll say, not all of them, like we have some very good colleges, private engineering colleges, which give you a very good placement opportunities, all those things, but many of them, I'm not saying all of them, but many of them, their courses are not that great. So it means I leave the decision to you guys. I'm not sort of against these colleges or anything like that. I don't have any personal vendetta on them, but generally the trend is lesser and lesser demand in these colleges. That's the reason I'm telling. And then we have IISc Master's program. So we are discussing about one all the top premium institutes we'll just go through all the premium institutes in this. So we have IISc, which is the best institute, as I told you. ME is going to be direct admission, and the rank expected is less than 10 or less than 15 in that category. And in case of M.Tech, where you have written test plus interview, your rank can be as good as some 100, 120, like that. That's what I told you, right? DESE is one department, and your we have another department here called M.Tech in, we have another department in IISc called as Supercomputer Education and Research Center. They do a lot of data analytics and stuff like that. So for that also, they accept all the branches of engineering. So you can try that as well. If your rank is more, you can apply that as well. Okay, then what are the things you have to prepare for the written test? It's going to be the GATE repeated again. But one small point you have to consider here is, it's not going to be, take, because this year GATE, I saw the instrumentation paper has been very, very easy compared to the last year, or I should say that this was the easiest instrumentation paper that has ever come in GATE in the last 10 years. So, the exam may not be that easy or that straightforward like what it was in GATE. You can expect a little more, because compared to 2017 GATE I'm talking, compared to 2017 GATE, you can expect the written exam to be tougher. And the things to prepare, all basic concepts. See, for when you are going to interview in any IIT, IISc, if you want to prepare, just focus on basics. Don't try to focus on some high funda things. Don't try to overread things which are not needed. Focus only on basics. Only basics. Okay, then. The most important thing for your interview will be, this is for written test as well as for interview. And for interview especially, you should be very clear in your BE project. Whatever you did as your BE or BTech project, you should be 100% clear on what you did, why you did, how you did. You are basically, let us say you did a project, let us say you used a some ICs or you did some project, you should be able to defend why you did that project, what is the benefit of that project. Like say, let us say I designed a circuit. What was the design consideration? What were the assumptions based on which this circuit was designed? How it was designed? Why a particular let us say, for example, you guys wanted to make an amplifier. Let us say you decided to make it using a inverting amplifier instead of a non-inverting amplifier. You should be able to tell why you chose the inverting configuration compared to the non-inverting configuration. Or why you chose a, let us say you have done a project using, let us say, Arduino. Or let us say you have done a project using, let us say, ARM or something like that. You should be able to say that why we selected that particular microcontroller for that project and how the logic of your project, let us say you have written some program or code into the microcontroller for doing something, what is the logic, why you choose this logic, how this is helping in solving the or achieving the mission of the project. Those things should be very clearly understood. Your BE project, don't try to do something very hi-fi, don't try to explain some hi-fi things here. All you need is only basics. In IIT and IISc, they will not ask you any hi-fi things, because see, if you already know the hi-fi things, then why you have to do them, right? Correct. To know, to go to the next higher level only, we are going there to study M.Tech and M.S. So, they will not expect you hi-fi things. All they will expect you is basics only. Many people, in the name of preparing for interview, they read all hi-fi stuffs and they miss the basics. So, that's the most important point. We focus on basics and all the concepts. Basics and concepts are most important. Shortcuts are not important. Okay. And things to prepare for the exam, mainly I will say that, let us say if you have, I will suggest you something like, so if you are, so these are the topics I will like you guys to, so then one thing is networks, then you have analog electronics, then digital electronics, control systems. These are the topics which is mainly needed for interview. And of course, basic maths. Maths is the second language in any IISc or IIT you go. So, or rather I should say first language. So, networks, in the sense you should be very clear in network theorems. Then, I should say two-port networks. Here, especially op-amp circuits. You should be able to design circuit with op-amps. Let us say I'm asking you to make a voltage regulator, or I'm asking you to make a current regulator, or I'm asking you to make an inverting amplifier. So all these things, op-amp based circuit design should be very clear. Digital electronics, state machines should be very clear. So something like, I'll tell you a few questions, these are very famous questions that have been asked in thing. Assume means you are free to assume your own conditions. Okay, assume your own conditions and design a state machine for an automatic washing machine or a coffee vending machine, something like. So you have to assume, okay, I load the clothes, then I press this button. Then first thing, water has to fill. Let us talk about a washing machine case. So first water has to fill. Then inlet valve has to close and then spin tub has to spin. For say, let us say 10 minutes or 20 minutes depending upon the wash program selected. Then you have to let out the water. So the drain valve has to open. Then when the drain valve will close, ensuring that the water level has completely drained out, the drain valve of the washing machine will close and then inlet valve will open. Correct. This is the correct sequence. Let us say your washing machine is washing. When the drain valve, without closing the drain valve, you start filling, whatever water is getting filled will get drained out also, right? So things, some basic, or otherwise you have coffee vending machine. Let us say it has a provision of vending coffee, black coffee, some espresso coffee, cappuccino, and let us say milk. So if I press different buttons, accordingly, it should give me the corresponding. Try to design a basic state machine like this. You can Google. So this will give you, these type of basic questions in digital electronics will give you a lot of insight in basic concepts. Those things are very, very important. State machine is one thing, very famous thing. Then flip-flops. Flip-flop circuits. Something like counter. All those circuits. In control systems, again, basics only they will ask. Basics of controllers. What is P action? What is I action? Why we need all these actions? And then basics of state variables. State space. So what do I mean by initial condition? What is the state? How it affects the output? How it affects the, depending upon the present state, what will be the next state, what is the state equations, what is the state, all these type of questions will come. And basic max, you should be very clear, and basics of calculus is very, very important. This is very, very important. I am not saying these are the only topics you need, but if you are clear with these topics and this topic, you have almost done your preparation for interview plus written test is what I will say. Then as we, means, this is not only for IISc, by the way, this is for anywhere in IISc, IIT or NITs, wherever you are going to have an interview, this is what they are going to ask. Even in PSU, let us say you are going for a PSU for based on, that also we will be discussing in couple of slides away, there also these are the main things that will be asked. And then we have IIT Delhi, which has direct admission. We have, as I told you, few departments have direct admissions. If your gate score is more than 900 or in that range. And for few non-direct admissions, they have for different for each department, they take interviews. And also, they will have this is not only what I have written here, is not only with respect to the IIT Delhi. Many IITs, they publish a waiting list. So, you can watch out for the waiting list and see whether you stand a chance in the next thing. And yeah, IIT Madras, they have a interdisciplinary systems and controls engineering, which is very good. They have a course in communication systems, which is very good. And they have IIT Madras has a tie-up with Texas Instruments, and they can give their MS program. This is a very, very good program in terms of analog circuit design. We have these couple of best-rated faculties in India will be teaching you this. Courses. So this is going to be a very beautiful program. This will have this MS program. The M.Tech is direct admissions. MS program will have a written test plus interview. And in case of IIT Kharagpur, it's only interview or direct admissions. And IIT Kanpur, they have power and control engineering, which is very good. And They have another course called Industrial Management and Industrial Engineering. They have a GD and personal interview for that course. This is a very beautiful course if you are, it's more of a techno-managerial career, I will say, if you go into this line. It's like almost like a MBA in operations. And then same is the case with NIT Mumbai. NIT Mumbai also, this MBA is going to be almost like a MBA. It's almost going to be something like an MBA in operations engineering. And then this, yes, this is a very, very beautiful institute, IIITs. We have IIITs. Few of them are called as International Institute of Information Technology, and few of them are called as Indian Institute of Information Technology. So we have them in Bangalore, Hyderabad, Allahabad and Gwalior. Of which only IIIT Bangalore, IIIT Allahabad and IIIT Gwalior, they accept the GATE score for M.Tech admissions. Only IIIT Hyderabad does not accept the GATE score, and they have their own written test. But again, as I told you, their written test is going to be, if you have done your GATE preparation diligently, it's going to be very easy for you. Again, they are going to focus only in basic concepts. And admission to all these institutes are based on, except for IIIT Hyderabad, they conduct their own entrance. The other IIITs, they are taking their admissions based on M.Tech, for their M.Tech based on GATE score plus the interview performance. And these institutes offer M.Tech as well as MS programs. And I'll say that these institutes are as promising as IITs. They have beautiful research facilities. I have visited the IIIT Bangalore and campus, I should say, that it's a very beautiful campus with a lot of promising research and career opportunities. And then the hotcakes of GATE, I'll say PSUs. PSUs is going to give you awesome career opportunities for people who are interested in looking for job after GATE. And many people, it has been like viewed like PSU job is like a government job, or it's going to be a mundane job doing the same thing again. No, PSUs are now on par with any competitive companies on these days, I'll say, because everybody knows the present day life is not that easy. So it's like the survival of the fittest. Only the guy who is having that competitiveness stays in the game. The guys who are not competitive enough are laid back. So PSUs nowadays, it's not the typical government job, I'll say. It's a very good career opportunity. They are as good as in pay wise, they are as good as any private sectors, I will say. And the job wise, it's a very beautiful job opportunities they are giving you. They are having, because they are on par with any cutting edge private companies on these days, like be it IOCL or BPCL or GAIL, SAIL, whatever it may be, they are on par with any other private companies in terms of their productivity and their capabilities and their competitiveness. So, and many students go for PSUs because it gives you a guaranteed job opportunity till almost 60 years of your life, which is very, very fantastic opportunity, I will say, given the present uncertainties in private sector. So, PSUs, the rank should be less than 500. It's a combination of your GATE score plus group discussion plus interview. It's almost same across all the PSUs, but it slightly differs. Like, for example, what I'm trying to say is slightly differs. In case of the interview itself, few PSUs restrict themselves to only technical interview. Few PSUs take technical interview plus a HR interview. Few PSUs have two rounds of technical interview. Few PSUs have two rounds of GD. It varies, but this is the broad trend. They keep based on the number of applications they are getting to have their filtering things. They massage their criteria from year to year a bit. And it's something going to be, again, every PSU follows a different pattern in the way they are going to rate. So they give around 65-85% weight to GATE score, and the remaining 35-40% or whatever is the remaining, it comes from the your performance in GD plus personal interview, or only personal interview, or how they take it through. And these are the interesting PSUs and their opportunities. What is the job opportunities in PSUs, I'll say. These are the top PSUs in India. So we have the NTPC, we have NTPC is the Thermal Power Corporation, National Thermal Power Corporation. So the job profile will be operation, maintenance and technical services, design and design and operation of thermal power plants. Given the power demands of our country, any power sector is going to be, in a funny way I have to say, it's a chiranjeevi, I will say, it's a everlasting, ever promising career, given the present power demands and the energy demands of our country, or for that matter any country in this globe. So industry, so PSUs like NTPC, NPCL, NPCL is Nuclear Power Corporation of India, and Bhavini, we have Bharatiya Nabikya Vidyut Nigam Limited, which is a sister concern of NPCL. They have a lot of promising careers in terms of operating in design of nuclear power plants. We have Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research called IGCAR and Baba Atomic Research Center called BARC. They also accept, IGCAR and BARC are not exactly PSUs. NPCL and Bhavini are PSUs. IGCAR and BARC are not PSUs. They are government research labs. But definitely the opportunities you get are very good in terms of design of nuclear power plants and in terms of latest cutting edge research facilities, I should say, especially in IGCAR and BARC. Then we have the Electronic Corporation of India Limited. For instrumentation guys, this is a very, very promising field, I'll say, because they have lot of nuclear reactor instrumentation, radiation monitoring devices and instrumentation for reactor control, which has to be very precise, and it'll be fun designing all these circuits. You will really sort of, it'll be literally fun doing all these things, I'll say. It'll be a lot of excitement and fun associated with that. And then we have BHEL, where they, for example, the BHEL, the reason I've listed is, like, they supply a lot of things to NPC, like NTPC, NPCL, Bhavini, or any other power plants wherever, which are around India. Their heavy machinery comes from BHEL or from L&T, companies like L&T or BHEL. L&T is a private sector. We have listed PSUs only here, something like BHEL. So the associated instrumentation for that high power machinery also BHEL designs and gives. So they have a very good opportunity in high power instrumentation. Then we have the ONGC, BPCL, IOCL, HPCL, basically the oil and gas sector. So again, with all these, basically all these are the oil refineries and oil mining type of plants they have. And we have, without instrumentation engineers, you cannot operate those plants, because everything is there is process control instrumentation. In any of these industries you go, what you do is completely process control instrumentation. In every company I have listed here, starting from NTPC till ONGC, BPCL, GAIL, be it power sector, be it petroleum sector, oil and gas sector, be it steel or iron sector or whatever sector it may be, or there are paper manufacturing industries also. In any of these categories, process control, all are based on process control industries. So process control instrumentation is, without process control instrumentation, you cannot have the industry up and running. So instrumentation engineers are very, very keenly sorted in these type of job profiles. And by the way, this is not the exhaustive list. This is only a representative list. What all the top PSUs that came to my mind, I have listed it here. And there are other PSUs also. I have not listed them here. And the salary range is also beautiful. Here, they give you a very, very attractive salary. It varies from 6 lakhs per annum to 16 lakhs per annum, depending upon which PSU and what is the job they are offering. And then we have the job opportunities outside, the M.Tech opportunities outside India, M.Tech or MS, that is your post-graduation opportunities outside India, higher studies. We have the NTU and NUS. NTU stands for Nanyang Technical University and NUS is National University of Singapore. So here, your gate score is, let us say your rank is around 400, 500, any score above 90 percentile gate score will be, or I should say instead of 90 percentile, I should say any rank less than say 400, 300 to 400, you can apply for NTU and NUS. And your the criteria for admission is not only gate score here. Here, they look at your gate score, and whenever you're applying for not only NTU and NUS, any foreign university you're applying, the state that they take something called as SOP, statement of purpose. So be very careful in giving your statement of purpose as to why you want to do the M.Tech or MS from that institute, and what is your motivation for doing the M.Tech or MS. And don't I'm sorry to say that many people go by Google for this. You can do Google for how to write a SOP, but don't try to copy the top SOPs in the thing, because those people know what are the how students are stealing the statement of purpose from others and giving it. So look into Google for getting ideas, but you write your own statement of purpose. Don't take somebody else's statement of purpose and put it as yours, the SOP, by just changing some is, was, but, if, there, and give it. Spend judicious time in giving your statement of purpose. It's very, very important. It is as important as your GATE score when you are applying for foreign universities. Not only for NTU and US, for that matter, any foreign university, let us say you have written your GRE, and based on GRE you are applying for some universities in US or UK or Germany or something like that. Even then, a properly worded SOP is very, very important. You can look into Google only for getting an idea. Don't take the SOP from Google and do it. That's all I have with me, guys. I wish you all success. And I wish all of you to be, whether it's a PSU job or it's your M.Tech or MS opportunities, I wish all of you get the, all of you achieve your dreams. Thank you, guys. Thank you.